Hello, welcome back to the Checkpoint. We are talking medical interns. There is a deadlock between the medical interns and the Ministry of Health about deployment. The Ministry of Health has advised that those who can actually pay for their internship can go ahead and get deployed to work in those different hospitals. But then what happens to those who cannot afford? And that's where the deadlock has been. We are speaking to Dr. Obuku Ekwaro, who is the former president of the Medical Association here in Uganda. And he is telling us, how can we resolve this? Who are these medical interns? And how important are they to our sector, our health sector here in the country? Doctor, you have just explained to us how important these interns are for our health sector and how they work. And you have already told us that the ministry actually understands how critical they are in our system. And you also agree that the ministry also acknowledges that contribution in this sector. You said that you also went to the speaker and explained these very facts to her. What were you able to achieve as a way of dealing with this deadlock between the medical interns and the Minister of Health?
Yeah, by the way, permit me address one critical thing. I put some notes here as we were having a break. You know, this selective deployment is very, very dangerous. It's going to set a precedent which we may be unable to reverse. It is going to privatize internship, and there are dangers of privatization. First of all, it's actually against labor laws to deploy a worker without pay. It is unacceptable totally. Two, it is discriminatory. SDG 10, reduce income inequalities. So children of the rich are going to be going there. So whichever way you look at this policy, yes, it is a desperate measure for desperate times, but whichever way you look at this policy, it is children of the rich who are going to be able to afford accommodation. Because internship is no joke. There is no time for side income. They work 25 hours a day, 8 days a week. If it were 3 days a week, then that would be understandable. The other 4 days, okubache you somewhere and get the income you need to pay rent and so on. That is why you take care of them. So what is happening in the long run? If you force the medical interns to do internship without pay, because they need it, and this is unfair because we are punishing, actually, our young medical doctors at the time they're getting into the profession, and punishing them with proposing an exam, and punishing them with not paying them, because they are most vulnerable. And some of us have said, no, we cannot accept this kind of thing. We will continue to ensure we mobilize and communicate till this changes. Because you are going to bring the quality of medical internship down. People are going to focus on how do we get money. And it will include extorting money from patients. The behavior you are trying to fight will now become official. Because I can guarantee you the circumstances under which these medical interns are exposed. Okay? The working conditions are not necessarily the best. Especially under emergency conditions, there is no this, there is no that, there is no this. Which was one of our prayers here to the speaker. They will be forced to extort money. Next, you are going to put in money to health monitoring unit to arrest interns. Okay? And then the medical association will jump and say, but you are not paying them. So it is a vicious cycle which will end badly. I must put this advice plainly to our honorable members of parliament and those who are concerned with giving ministry money. The corollary is to just give ministry money. In any case, there is money to deploy interns when I had the response from the minister. That was one of our achievements, to hit the bush and bring the matter back. Remember the previous week, Parliament had passed a supplementary. I have not got the figures correct, but yeah, it was in trillions. Some are saying 2.9 trillion. I have tried to look for the paperwork. I have not found it. Even comrades in Parliament who are medical doctors have not been able to access it. But it was passed, 2.9 trillion. Medical internship, which was 0.something% of it, okay? Perhaps 3%. 8 billion was not there. So you sit and wonder, at yak, sugar. These are important. Eh? They are very important, especially as we progress to invest in them. But couldn't we have said, okay, at yak, instead of all these 200 or whatever billion, why don't we cut 10, put here, cut 20 from Munyon, cut. Okay, let's get 40 billion, give Ministry of Health, start. Within 6 months, we should have got some money.
There is but about they gave 20 billion that was allocated to interns. Mm-hmm. And are you grateful for that?
Very grateful.
Yes.
Very grateful. And
is it going to be helpful?
Yes, but when you calculate at a maximum rate of 2.5 million shillings per month, you can deploy all the about 2,000 medical interns and pay them for 2.5 months. Okay? Of course, part of it was for arrears, but the minister specified that 8 billion was to deploy interns. And then 2 billion for senior house officers in the new financial year. It can start. So my thinking with others of the same lot, study group, is that that 8 billion, instead of deploying these 348 who have volunteered, and by the way, we have to be careful that this money is also not used because these are children of the rich. They can WhatsApp the payers at Ministry of Health and you find that they are volunteering when actually they are being paid with the 8 billion. So that 8 billion should, in my view, if they must be deployed, then deploy everyone. We are equal before the law and before God. Deploy everyone, let them go and have money for 2 months, and hopefully the Ministry of Finance will get another 2 months, even if it comes at month 3 or 4. You know, they keep pushing. And so on and so forth. Let me just finish the prayers.
Okay.
What did we achieve in Parliament? Mm. We also prayed. We made an addendum. It was triggered by internship, but we made an addendum. We realized the senior house officers, who are the Special Forces Command, SFC, of the medical profession, were also not catered for. They needed 21 billion. The medical interns needed 60 billion. The two comes to 80. That's why they talk about 80.5. Then we also discovered that there are things which you cannot buy when you are an intern and you are working.
Mm.
Blood, oxygen, those two. It appears we have an excess of oxygen, given that we really stocked and planned, then COVID disappeared. I understand we can even export it. But we have a serious shortage of blood, and their budget perhaps did not cater for new blood banks in Soroti, where the Honorable Speaker comes from, and Gulu, where the Honorable former Speaker, the Soro SMPs, comes from. Those two areas need 7 billion. That was also our prayer. But of course, the press covers internship and the striking, and they forget that. Because you see, with blood, unlike medicine for malaria, you can't buy it anywhere. Okay? And when they sell you blood in hospital, that's wrong. That person should be reported to the authorities, including the RDC. The other one was essential medicines. Let me just give a brief story. I buried my grandmother about 3 weeks ago in Loro City. Loro City is between Kamdini and Lira City. Okay? There now, there is a hospital called Abel International Hospital. There's a Nyeke Health Center for some health center threes. So during the burial, of course, I met an old lady. She said, oh, Buka, you're the one I hear already. I said, I'm the one. Thank you for fighting. But now there are no medicines. I said, is it true? So when I was castigating the health workers after we have fought for their salaries and it has been increased by this government, thank you very much, it was a very good thing. They are going to hospital, they are not. So I was there feeling very confident. I said, you know, we fought for your salaries, health workers, you should make sure. Because my mother died, my grandmother, 83, had died in hospital. Should make sure, please, you attend to our people. And the DHO stood up and said, you know, when she responded to that time to speak, said, you don't know. Yeah? The national medical stores, out of the 6 deliveries, 6 cycles, every 2 months, National Medical Stores makes some deliveries of medicines. Had only delivered 2 out of 6. And remember, the financial year was ending. So they did not believe that 4 would be coming. If 2 have come over 11 months, the last month you can't bring 4. It just doesn't add up. So in Oyama district, the National Medical Stores, in terms of delivering medicines and drugs, is operating at 33%. So one of our prayers was, we understand the National Medical Stores has a deficit of 100 billion. When you had 100 billion plus this 80, that's 180, 81 plus 788, 200 billion. It's perhaps less than even 8% of the 2.9 trillion supplementary. Can sort out these things. Very good politics to deliver services to the people, as long as we ensure we also fight corruption to make sure when you put 100 million in medicine, it reaches. When you put 7 billion in drug, in blood, it reaches. So these were the four prayers to the speaker. And in policy sciences, we did very well, according to policy, because the matter came back to the agenda. And people remembered it. That, last week you passed a supplementary, but there was nothing on internship. Can we put something? I hear another one is coming, another supplementary before the end of this month, before the new year, financial year. I hope at least put 40 billion for internship. The minister is confident, the PS is confident, they can pay. Then send them out there when they have assured commitment for at least 6 months. I think what I would assume, the Ministry of LPS and so on, they are attempting to prevent a scenario where you send people in the field, then after a month or two, they are back to striking. We have no food, we have no accommodation, how can we work hungry? But at the same time, you are curing the problem by sending hungry people there.
Okay, I like that as you're talking about the prayers, you're also talking about how this can be resolved. And the fact that you have been able to look into the health sector and be able to identify certain areas where there is money. But I want us to put this issue into perspective. We are talking about three cohorts. That means the problem of COVID comes into perspective because COVID has been here for at least 3 years, since 2020. Yeah. And you know that in the 90s, the 1990s, we still had only one medical school, that was Mulago then, that was churning out people with bachelors and what, in the health sector. And now the health ministry has to deal with a number of other institutions that also have these pre-interns, and they have to get deployed. And then in the midst of this unique challenge of COVID, they have to find a way of how things can work. Can you advise the ministry going forward? How this can be dealt with?
Thank you. That's a very important question. In fact, I thought you are fit to be a commissioner there, of at least internship. Now, I cannot really advise. Those are my seniors. Dr. Diana Atwine is my senior. She knows this thing. She has been in the system, and she has that unique perspective. Okay, and of course, Dr. Jane Ruth Acheng. I mean, she's been there. You know, many more years, perhaps 30 years plus in the service. So they know what to do. But I feel their frustration, perhaps. Okay? By the time they decide to deploy people without money, it's a desperate measure. And this is what I want to bring into place.
And by the way, just a small hint, don't you think it is also a measure to help these pre-interns who actually want to get this skill, but then there's this whole problem that we are talking
the
about?
Barrier.
Yes.
By the way, let me say something. Generally, from the perspective of public policy, when you introduce a new policy, you also have to know that new policy interventions bring side effects or policy problems, just like any drug. Okay, they say if you take Panadol, it will remove pain. But if you take 20 tablets, it can shut down your liver. Okay? The policy of privatization and liberalization of the education sector had positives from one university or one medical school, Mulago, Tumbarara, government alone, Guru, Busitema, now Soroti, Mountain of the Moon is going to be absorbed, Kabale. These are government, by the way, and I hear Lira, my home city, which is beautiful. Is the demand there? Yes, the demand is there. What is the policy problem coming about? I read the new vision that government is going to check the quality. Okay? But it's a question of uncoordinated policies. They are not comprehensive. It appears, and I read this from the policy brief from the office of the president about working in silos. Government, MDAs, ministries, departments, and agencies working in silos. There is a policy brief they have written, 4 pages. You can read it. And they were encouraging integration of government programs. And I think this is what motivated the so-called program-based budgeting, so that human capital, education and health are under one, human capital development. It appears there has been, okay, open schools, National Council of Education, Ministry of Education, open medical schools. Mm-hmm. The thing that I see from discussing with elders who were there before, they tell us medical school was under, medical training was under Ministry of Health. The generals were training the privates. Have you seen police, prisons, and UPDF being trained by Ministry of Education?
No.
Aren't there colleges, Kimaka?
No.
Are they under Ministry of Education?
No.
So why are these ones of medical school under Ministry of Education? Because ours is more than simply go to class, churn out books. It is actually, when we say it is a calling, it doesn't mean you are privileged to serve, but you must serve. And during our altercation with the state in 2017, we argued that, by the way, if Jesus is seated on the right hand of the Father, then for us we are on the left. Reason being is that we are only too privileged to be between God and a life, not arrogant about it, but such a privilege that even money cannot buy that opportunity, that when you find yourself able to save a life, save it without thinking about money. You know what I mean?
Yes.
But we can't starve in that direction.
Mm.
So Ministry of Health, having understood that, should do away with this policy. These many doctors, many nurses, is a blessing. Population has grown. His Excellency the President, although I had him denying Vision 2040, he even said that budget of years. But now, during the State of the Nation address, at least he recognized that in his government, the economy has grown nearly 40 times.
Mm.
The population perhaps 3, 4, 5 times. Maybe we're 15 million, now we're over 45. Okay? And Uganda in general has become a richer country. But there is a disparity. There are areas which are neglected. How can we make sure that the gaps, the human resource gaps, which were 16,000 medical professionals by 2020, by 2025, the gap will be 25,000 medical professionals. By 2030, because now we are going by the SDG, Sustainable Development Goals, Agenda 2030, by 2030, 30,000 medical professionals. Where am I getting these figures? I didn't calculate them. I simply opened the Human Resources for Health Strategic Plan for Ministry of Health. It is all in there. So this policy is anti the strategic plan of Ministry of Health. Ministry of Finance and Parliament must find this money.
Mm.
This policy is anti-parish development model, where we are saying agricultural services should be found at the parish. Education, okay, food security, education security, and also health. We actually look at the Ministry of Public Service restructuring. They released a new structure of health, government health facilities, which is going to be implemented, I understand, over the next 10 years. And they have put a medical doctor at Health Center 3, really taking the service across to the people. So when you introduce such a policy, where have you, as you have said, there is a barrier to accessing your independence to practice, because you can't get a license, okay? Then you're actually not feeding into NDP3. You're not feeding into your strategic plan as Ministry of Health. Of course, they are being frustrated by those who are not releasing the money. And you are not helping the global goals. You're going to attain the global goals. We are still going to go back to unfinished business. By 2015, the unfinished business was mothers dying, very young children dying, and others. But mothers dying was one of the highest dying during childbirth. If interns are a very critical resource, Kawempe Hospital, wherever, these 50, 55 centers, handling mothers in time. The other critical thing is, if you stop me from practicing legally, I'm going to practice illegally. And who will know anyway? The medical council is weak. The professional councils are weak. Our sector is regulated automatically by itself. I must regulate myself, I must take pride in practicing professionally. By the time the medical council catches me, I've really committed the atrocities. You know what I mean?
Yes.
The patient has complained. But doctors take pride in saving a life. That alone,
and doing the right thing.
You go back home, take a beer or take coffee, or go and watch a soccer match, and you have pride when a patient sends you a WhatsApp and says, you know, doctor, my child is so well. My father was a medical doctor, I saw this. The pride was in saving a life. They gave him tracts and tracts of land in Maasai land. He never dug even a quarter an acre. Because
so
his calling
advice,
was that pride.
What advice do you give to these medical interns who are waiting to be deployed and are not even falling into that category of those who can actually pay for themselves?
Of course, before we give advice, we diagnose. Mm. So then they will be suffering from poverty. Poverty of opportunity. Poverty of self-determination. Okay? You are being denied the opportunities. So I don't have to give advice. I can describe what is likely to happen. They are likely to migrate to other countries to try and do internship. Okay? They are likely to hate Uganda. As soon as they finish internship, they say, I don't want to be in that country which treats us so badly. And then we are talking about what? Patriotism, teaching them in classes. You don't need to teach an intern doctor patriotism. Just let the speaker read and say, Honorable Minister, we are inviting the Minister of Finance to give a statement. And the Minister of Finance, Honorable Kasaija, says, members of the House, out of the 60 billion, we have found 40. That is the biggest impact you can have on the life of a medical intern as a patriot, that we were remembered and we were prioritized.
Mm.
Okay? So I think they should hang on. The elders are trying to resolve this impasse, as you call it. We volunteered to come in and stop this striking business, because we are the grandmasters of striking, but it's not necessary where it has reached. The attention has been caught. We just need to work with the policy processes, but make it faster. Dr. Ramadan Gobi, my professional friend, could do some magic and perhaps cut a few shillings here, put it there, and so that these interns can work. But also, government should look at this as an investment. Let me tell you why. There's a huge demand for medical doctors, professional degree nurses, pharmacists, and also midwives and dentists in the global north. What has happened is that the average age, the median age, I think, in Africa is 15 years, meaning on average, if you talk our age, 50% of the people are below 50 years. In the global north, it's perhaps above 50 years. Japan, UK, North America, you know, USA and Canada. There is a demand we cannot satisfy by even exporting doctors. That demand we can't satisfy it. So if they invest that 80 billion in these medical interns, and then they say, okay, we cannot absorb all of you. Out of the 1,000 doctors, we will export, we'll absorb 500, let's export 500 in an agreement. And I hear states like Tennessee, I was seeing a TikTok, but I'm yet to verify with the American Medical Association whether it's true, that the demand for medical doctors in the USA is so high that they are beginning to soften their rules, so that if you do internship in Uganda, you go and do just an abbreviated course there to make sure you know what you're talking about, okay? And their problem are really non-communicable diseases, blood pressure, heart disease, and so on. Then you join the system, and they can hire you. I can tell you, there was a time when repatriations from Kuba Cheyos, whom we used to laugh at when they were going, the money they sent back was more than tourism, was perhaps more than coffee. I need to check my facts, but I think at one time I saw in the New Vision that it was more than coffee. I think it was a research article. So if we invest and export this highly skilled labor in an organized fashion, a bit better than Middle East, where they are treating our people badly sometimes,
mm-hmm.
more organized, externalize this labor, but have organized agreements with the labor unions on that side, labor unions on this side, helping government, because government alone can't do everything. Agreements between Uganda Medical Association and American Medical Association to monitor and make sure they are well treated, even if they earn half the salaries of the Americans. What they send back here will sort out these potholes. And it can even sort out the aid we get through that kind of trade agreement.
Doctor, my time is fast spent, but I just want to ask you one question.
Yes.
You have had lots of ideas on this show talking about how these issues can be handled.
Yes.
And even the wider health issues when you're talking about repatriation of the medics and all. What is your final advice to the Minister of Health and the President?
Well, I don't know whether I have the capacity to advise the President and the Minister of Health, but we can share views which
are... Well, you do, you're a stakeholder.
Yeah, which have percolated from the discussions. We have a consultants forum, very, very good ideas, but how do we synthesize those? Interns themselves, I talked to them, I said, what? Of course, Dr. Nakimule Ethrelda has noticed and did a survey which showed that quite a number of the medical pre-interns are depressed. So there are those short-term immediate measures. She's counseling group, she's starting sessions of group counseling every Sunday after 6, invite medical interns who can come with their parents. But the most perhaps effective treatment is to remove what is causing this depression. You're not staying home for 1 year. Mm-hmm. When you join, and by the way, this is the impact also of this policy. When you joined with the pride that I got double A, triple A, and so on, I was the best in St. Mary's College, Kisubi, or Lira SS, or Bushenyo, wherever, Karamoja, and so on, because we are beginning to see also doctors come from Karamoja, quite a number of them. Government scholarship, I'm the pride of my school. Then I'm treated. That policeman is pulling me down there in Mulago when I want to march to Parliament. That sight discourages people who are doing sciences. So apart from counseling, we as professionals are also thinking of going back to schools as a medical association. We have 14 branches. Go to these major schools and begin to encourage people that medicine is still a course you can do with pride. Number three is government must find money and give to the Ministry of Health. Or commit. I heard the Minister of Health saying, commit. Number four, instead of deploying 348, medical interns who have volunteered because they are desperate or their parents are rich, are able to afford, deploy all the 1,900. Number five, government must communicate, Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education, to agree at what point shall we chase profits as private universities and at what point shall we handle quality. I do not think we have the capacity. By the way, they are not three cohorts, they are two. The one which waited for 1 year, about 2,000, and the one which has just finished or is finishing, another 2,000. So they are in total 4,000. But it's okay, we can deploy the 2,000, and then perhaps in 6 months, find money to deploy a bit over there. Along the way, by the way, people change their minds. I can guarantee you this profession here, those who have come out, the 1,901, I'm sure a number of them are already trading in Chikubo and cursing why they spent 5 years in a medical school instead of going in Chikubo. In 5 years, they would have had an arcade.
Oh, I'm sorry about that, but we've got to close this discussion. I pray that the Minister of Health definitely finds the money through a Minister of Finance that is supposed to have the Parliament appropriate the money to these medical interns so that they can actually get to practice their profession. I have been Vivian Kamsime with Dr. Obuku Ekwaro, the former president of Uganda Medical Association. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.